So our basic architecture for this data set is we have a geodatabase that consists of the National Hydrography Dataset and the Watershed Boundary Dataset. And when we display those together, it looks like this. The blue lines you see there are the National Hydrography Dataset. They're the streams that make up the surface water network. And then we can see these multicolored polygons that make up the Watershed Boundary Dataset. And we can see how these stream networks neatly fit within these hydrologic drainage areas. So in our design of a data set, we might want to look at more information besides just the National Hydrography Dataset and the Watershed Boundary Dataset. We might want to look at other information such as the National Wetlands Inventory and 100-year floodplains such as might be found in the DFIRM dataset. So these data sets can all work together in a geodatabase. We have other types of water information, such as point source discharges, biologic habitat, stream gauges, impaired waters, drinking water intakes, diversion structures, dams. And then the NHDPlus data set, which we'll talk about in a minute, a very rich data set that contains all kinds of additional information. And we can link this information using pointers, using these network addresses. So for example, look at a point source discharge. Where is that located? Well, we know the address on the network, and we can link that to other types of data sets, to the National Wetlands Inventory, to the National Hydrography Data Set. All this type of information can be related to each other using these network addresses and explicitly identify where things are in relation to each other. We know what's upstream, what's downstream of each other. We know how far away it is. We know lots of information about the relationships of data. So for example here, in trying to identify the relationship between A, B, and C, this can easily be done simply by looking at a map. We don't need a GIS system to do that. We can just look at a map and figure this out. But an example here where we have many thousands of points, this is too complicated to figure out just by looking at a map. So we really need a geographic information system and a data structure such as we find in the National Hydrography Dataset and the Watershed Boundary Dataset to understand these relationships. So for example, we have a stream gauge, this red triangle that you see in the image. We want to know what water diversions are upstream of that stream gauge and affect the flow of water through that stream gauge. So we can navigate upstream and identify all those stream gauges. The cyan colored circles you see there, those are the diversions that are upstream of the stream gauge. The black dots you see there are also diversions, but they're not upstream of the stream gauge. So using a system such as the NHD, it's easy to figure out the relationship of information to each other. Traditionally, in a GIS, we overlay information and look at the spatial relationships. This doesn't work quite as well in a hydrography system because the way that surface water information is related is through the network, not just through space. So we need these explicit relationships that we find in the data model to understand how things relate to each other within the network and not just through space. So one of the things we can do with this type of information is to create a map such as this, which shows the surface water flow through the state of Washington. And the width of the blue lines that you see there tell us how much water is flowing through the streams on mean annual flow basis. And this is a model that gives us a picture of where the water is in the state of Washington flowing through the surface water stream network. This works by taking information such as the National Hydrography Dataset, the Watershed Boundary Dataset, and the National Elevation Dataset, and combining this together to create catchments. And so here the blue lines that you see are the stream network, and then the multicolored polygons you see there are catchments. It's kind of like the Watershed Boundary Dataset, but at a much more detailed level. You can see that each individual stream segment has its own polygon, its own drainage area. That drainage area can then be intersected with other types of data to get information on that drainage area, such as the precipitation in that area, the temperature, the elevation, the slope, the land cover, how much of the land is forest, how much is agriculture, how much of it is urban area. We can take all this type of information and model it to get the stream flow information that you see on a map like this. And so using modeling techniques, we can predict how much water will be in each one of these stream segments. and then represent the amount of water using the line width to represent that. Something else we can do is look at a system such as this and account for the diversions of water. So the blue lines you see there are the natural flow that you'd expect in the surface water system of Colorado. What we've done is then accounted for the water that's withdrawn through water diversions. The red dots you see on this map are water that transfers water across a continental divide. There are 56 of these. There are 5 of them that are particularly significant. So what we've done is we've used the pink lines to represent water withdrawn by these diversions. So these rivers actually have less water in them. And then the purple lines represent the rivers in which water has been added to them. So we've taken the blue lines and then made them wider and turned them into these purple lines because water has been added through the transcontinental divide diversions. Just an example of some of the things we can do to improve our understanding of the water of the United States. How is the NHD and WBD used? Well, for example, at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, they look at pesticide risk assessment, look at where pesticides are applied on the landscape, how this affects endangered species, for example, flowing downstream, looking at water samples and looking upstream, and seeing where the pesticides are coming from. One of the things that they do with the U.S. EPA is look at water discharge permits and link these to the NHD. So giving each one of these points an address on the network, such as we saw earlier in the example of the stream gauge. One of the things that can also be done is look at time of travel. We can look at a water contaminant entering the water system at a certain point and flowing downstream to a drinking water intake. And if there's a contaminant at the water, we can look at the breakthrough curve that you see in the upper right-hand corner. This tells us over a period of time. The y-axis tells us the concentration of the contaminant in the water. The x-axis looks at a point on the river and the time interval when that contaminant plume first reaches the drinking water intake, when peak concentration arrives, and then at the trailing edge of the plume as the contaminant passes by the drinking water intake. It allows emergency responders to close off the drinking water intake until the threat has passed. In California, for example, they use the National Hydrography Dataset to look at water rights. And so where water rights used to be something that was just manually stored on index cards and maps, we now can do this through a GIS system using a web portal such as the WRIMS system in the state of California to allow citizens to look at the water rights in the state of California. In Missouri, what they've done is look at fish species. They've taken 316 different fish species and index these or reference these to the NHD. So we know, for example, where the Ozark minnow lives, the wedge spot shiner, the southern red-bellied dace. You can see these in red. It shows us which streams in the state of Missouri these species live in. Something else we're interested in is looking at fish barriers. So one of the issues in California is steelhead trout migration to spawning grounds and the barriers in the river systems that prevent the steelhead trout from reaching their spawning grounds. So we can look at complete fish passage barriers, partial barriers, and potential barriers, and map those out in the river system. There's also a system called Spiral, which allows us to look at nutrient loads in rivers in the United States. In this case here, we're looking at nitrogen loads. The red colors are the highest concentrations of nitrogen. And this system uses an example of the National Hydrography Dataset, an earlier version of it, and as they modernize this system, they will use the National Hydrography Dataset for this type of modeling. Some of the issues that we're concerned about is trying to keep up with the change in the hydrography of the U.S. You can see here the stream. Each different color of the stream represents a different 10-year interval of that stream being mapped. And we can see that throughout time, the stream from 1944 to 56 to 72, 81, 92, and 2006, the stream has changed course many times. We need to keep up with that change. Here's an example of the NHD in blue, and you overlay this on a contemporary image, and you can see that the stream has changed course since it was last mapped, and we need to keep up with change like this. So we have different densities or different scales of the National Hydrography Dataset. This is what we call the medium resolution NHD. It represents 1 to 100,000 scale density of streams. And we also have a 1 to 24,000 scale representation of the NHD. And many of our customers have asked for even more detail in the NHD, and we can see this in this example of what we call the local resolution NHD. One of the things that's being done is to derive local resolution NHD from LIDAR data. What we've done is we've mapped the streams from LIDAR data in red and then overlaid this with the 24,000 scale NHD in blue. And you can see that the existing NHD in blue pretty much represents the LIDAR-derived streams to an extent, but then the red lines that you see sticking out of the blue lines are an extension of the network. There are additional streams that can be gathered using the LIDAR information. Canada and Mexico are also building datasets, such as the National Hydrography Dataset and the Watershed Boundary Dataset. This is an example of Canadian data on the top and U.S. data on the bottom. And for this hydrologic unit, we're combining the data from Canada and the U.S. into one hydrologic unit. So when you take a look at data in Canada or Mexico over the border, it becomes seamless information and it allows scientists to study the border regions without regard for the political boundaries. We're doing the same thing with Mexico. Here you see Mexican data on the bottom and U.S. data on the top side of the red line, combining this together into one seamless hydrologic unit. So we're adding lots of information to the NHD to make the NHD more intelligent. The black squares you see there are the dams. The red triangles are stream gauges. Also, we're looking at things like water diversions, such as this tunnel that goes under the Continental Divide connecting the two green dots you see there. One of the things that we're concerned about, too, is hydrography over urban areas. So this is looking at Minneapolis, and we can see some hydrography represented here in the dark and lighter blue colors. But a lot of the surface hydrography actually flows underground through culverts. And so we can take a look at the major culverts that drain the water through the system and add these to the NHD to get a more complete picture of hydrography over in urban areas, even though this hydrography is flowing underground through culverts. We have the same problem over karst topography. This is where water is flowing underground through limestone caves and other types of caves. The green and blue lines that you see here are the NHD and WBD surface water. The red lines that you see there are underground streams flowing through karst terrain. So we'd like to be able to add these to the NHD to get a better understanding of how the surface flow works. One of the things that we do is we maintain the National Hydrography Dataset through a stewardship process where we have a number of states who have joined with the USGS and keep the NHD up to date. We have 35 states that are in our stewardship network right now, and the USGS acts as a facilitator for this process, and then the states maintain the data and keep it up to date. And then also other organizations work through the states, such as the U.S. Forest Service and the Bureau of Land Management work through the states. Other organizations, such as the City of New York, would work through the State of New York. In Arkansas, for example, the State Engineer's Office or the Department of Environmental Quality work through the state steward to keep the National Hydrography Data set up to date. Then we have a process to facilitate this where we have experts who work in different regions of the U.S. to help keep the NHD up to date and to answer questions. And so you can go to this web map, click on a state, and find out who to contact to maintain the NHD and keep it up to date. So this is an overview of the National Hydrography Dataset and the Watershed Boundary Dataset. One of the things we're also concerned with is how do we reach our customers? And in this trumpet-shaped curve here, we have on the top our expert users, in the middle our knowledgeable users, at the bottom our more casual users. And one of the things we want to do with the NHD is to make sure that we're addressing our full customer range and not just providing advanced capabilities, but capabilities that will meet the needs of all users at all levels of expertise.